Hi, I'm Jesse Alexander, and welcome to the Great War. The lands of the Ottoman Empire had been mostly occupied by the Allies in 1918 and 1919 in the anticipation of a peace treaty that would create a new order in the Middle East. The British, French, Italians, and eventually Greeks all sent troops to fight in different parts of the region, and all fought against the rising forces of the Turkish nationalist movement under Mustafa Kemal Pasha over the next several years. In the southern province of Cilicia, French and Armenian troops clashed with the Turks in a messy campaign that came to an end with the Treaty of Ankara in October 1921. So today, we'll take a look at the Franco-Turkish War of 1919 to 1921, also known as the Cilicia Campaign, or the Southern Front of the Turkish War of Liberation. And it all happened exactly 100 years ago. After the armistice of 1918, the French occupied Cilicia, Syria, and Lebanon on the basis of the Anglo-French Sykes-Picot Agreement of 1916, which planned to divide up the Middle East between Britain and France. The powerless Ottoman government in Constantinople agreed to the occupations, but the Turkish nationalist movement in central Anatolia was prepared to resist by force of arms. When French troops arrived, they were accompanied by the French-led 4,000-strong Légion d'Orient, made up of Armenians and some other Christians from the Middle East. Cilicia had a large Armenian minority before 1915, and thousands who'd fled the Armenian genocide during the First World War now returned home under French protection. British and French authorities pushed for a quick resettlement, and in the first half of 1919 alone, about 110,000 Armenian refugees from camps in Lebanon and Syria arrived in Cilicia. Many found their former homes occupied or destroyed. Trouble began in Cilicia almost as soon as the first two French divisions arrived. These forces were too small to control the region and secure the border of the French zone of occupation, which soon expanded to include southeastern Anatolia. Many Turks resented the presence of the French in Armenians, especially since the French used the Armenian Legion as a police force. Some legionnaires committed revenge killings and treated the Turkish population harshly, to the point where the French eventually disbanded the Legion in 1920. At the same time, armed Turkish groups in the countryside targeted Armenian villages. The situation got even trickier for the French to handle when Turkish nationalist forces began to engage in fully organized resistance under the orders of Mustafa Kemal at the end of 1919. Kemal saw the Southern Front as a critical part of the War of Liberation. In the National Pact program that we adopted, the French-occupied areas fall within the borders we have drawn. And these areas also need to be cleared of the enemy. But for us, it is not just a question of Cilicia. This is a matter of preserving our entire existence. The French were soon hard-pressed to maintain their supply lines through the countryside, as inter-ethnic violence and partisan activities of Turkish irregulars increased. French Lieutenant Colonel Goudot reported on the difficult situation. "The Turks compared our occupation in Cilicia to that of the Greeks in Smyrna. The nationalists saw it as the dismemberment of their empire they would not accept for any price. On the other hand, it would have been better politics for us not to rely on the Armenian Legion. But this was imposed upon us by the speed of our occupation before reinforcements arrived. This justified the fears of the Muslims, who considered the presence of the Armenians as a provocation. Once Turkish guerrillas were reinforced with regular troops and artillery, they surrounded the city of Marash in January 1920. After a three-week siege, on February 10th, the French withdrew, and Marash became the first major city in the French zone to fall to the nationalist Turks. Turkish irregulars had already been raiding Armenian villages in the area, and now that the French garrison had left Marash, they put the city's Armenian quarter to the torch and killed many Armenian residents." Abraham Hartunyan described the aftermath. After 23 days of war and imprisonment, this was my first walk in the streets. But oh, what a horrible scene! Corpses, large and small, corpses of men, women, children, soldiers, littered the snow-covered ground. Even carcasses of animals were scattered all over. The snow was red. Another Armenian section was in flames. As the Franco-Armenian forces and Armenian refugees withdrew towards Syria, Armenian legionaries exacted revenge with deadly attacks on Turkish villagers along the way. The Turkish nationalists soon began to bottle up French garrisons and outposts, including the cities of Urfa and Ayin Tab. French troops were so overstretched that they simply couldn't be everywhere they were needed at once. Urfa's 500-man garrison capitulated on April 10th, and as they withdrew towards friendly territory, the Turks attacked and killed most of them. Ayin Tab, where Armenians made up about one quarter of the 60,000 residents, fell to Turkish insurgents on April 9, 1920. This was the first of a series of sieges of the city that caused Ayin Tab to be nicknamed the Turkish Verdun. About 2,000 French troops soon recaptured the town, but some 6,000 to 9,000 Turks besieged them again in May and launched repeated attacks before a two-week local truce was agreed on May 30th. Fighting resumed at Ayin Tab again in July, when the Turks began to bombard the reduced French garrison. On August 8th, a telegram reached the hard-pressed French telling them that a relief column under Lieutenant Colonel Andrea was on the way. The French and Armenian garrison forced their way out of the city to link up with Andrea, and the Turks entered Ayin Tab again. The combined French force, now 12,000 strong with 16 guns and a few tanks, then besieged the 9,000 Turkish troops in Ayin Tab in August. The Turks desperately tried to break the French positions around the city, but on February 9, 1921, local Turkish forces capitulated after a siege of more than 6 months. To honor the stubborn defense of the city, the Turkish government renamed it to Gazi Ayin Tab, or Warrior Ayin Tab, a name that the city retains to this day. So the French had managed a hard-fought tactical victory at Ayin Tab. But France was under pressure from constant Turkish attacks and had other troops tied up in Syria and Lebanon. So the government decided to negotiate. French Prime Minister Aristide Briand decided to end the war with Turkish nationalists in Cilicia and began talks with Kemal's representative Bekir Sami Bey in early 1921. The French had previously been strong advocates of the Armenian cause, but Briand's government changed course because it felt its position in the Middle East was in danger. French troops were facing Arab resistance in the new mandates in Syria and Lebanon, and the campaign in Cilicia was straining the budget and costing French lives. France's Armenian ally had also been defeated by the Turks in Armenia proper in late 1920. On March 12th, unbeknownst to the British, the French and Turkish nationalists agreed to end hostilities, but this deal fell apart. Even so, when news of a possible French withdrawal reached Cilicia in March, some French soldiers like Lieutenant Colonel Abadi feared their sacrifices had been in vain. The news caused great surprise, even among many Turks. After the enormous sacrifices accepted by the French at Ayin Tab, the efforts of an entire year which were needed for victory, the cession of Ayin Tab to the Turks is not understood. Franco-Turkish negotiations continued between French diplomat Henri Franklin Bouillon and Yusuf Kemal, and eventually led to the Treaty of Ankara being signed on October 20, 1921. The French gave up their claims on Ottoman territory and agreed to withdraw their 80,000 men from Cilicia and southern Anatolia by January 4, 1922. In exchange, the Turkish nationalists granted France some economic concessions and recognized French control over Syria and Lebanon. The fate of the Sanjak of Alexandretta, which was also under French control, was to be determined later. These terms unofficially opened the possibility for a potential renegotiation of the 1920 Treaty of Sèvres, which was to give large territories to Armenia and Greece. This treaty had been signed by the Ottoman government and the Allies in August 1920, but hadn't yet been implemented because of the resistance of Kemal's nationalists. Kemal saw the Ankara Treaty with the French as the defeat of Sèvres. The Treaty of Ankara proved to the whole world that the Treaty of Sèvres was merely a rag. The Treaty of Ankara might have removed some of the strain on France in the Middle East, but it was a serious blow to Anglo-French relations. In the eyes of the British government, France had gone behind its back and made a separate peace with an enemy. Colonial Secretary Winston Churchill did not mince words when he heard rumors of the Franco-Turkish deal. If true, the treaty would unquestionably convict the French government of what, in the most diplomatic application of the phrase, could only be deemed as an unfriendly act. Such a treaty is designed not merely to safeguard French interests in Turkey, but to secure those interests, wherever necessary, at the expense of Great Britain. The British also feared that the French withdrawal might embolden the Turks to attack the British-controlled former Ottoman territory of Iraq. Franklin Bouillon, though, felt French policy was justified. In Cilicia, France was expending 5 million francs a year and had buried some 5,000 of its sons. France had incurred these losses in defense of the Armenians. France could make such sacrifices no longer, and there was no need, in view of these facts, to defend the decision to arrange a peace with the government of the Grand National Assembly of Turkey. The treaty also had serious consequences for the Armenians living in the French zone, who feared that without French protection, the nationalist Turks would repeat the genocidal policies of the Ottomans in the Great War. French and Turkish nationalist authorities tried to convince the Armenians that they wouldn't be in danger and should stay in Cilicia. But most Armenians and other Christians in the region simply fled on ships provided by the Allies. Some Turkish historians have argued they fled out of guilt for atrocities committed against Turks, but most Armenians left because they were afraid for their lives. Armenian Vahan Portukalyan described the city of Adana in November 1921. With the execution of the Ankara Accord of October 20th, the evacuation of Cilicia has effectively begun. As soon as the news spread, the exodus of Christians began in proportions that no one could have imagined. It's useless to tell you about the crowding at the station. The Armenian quarters, so populated, even overpopulated, even 2 weeks ago, look like deserts. Does anyone in France have an idea of the suffering of these past 15 years? With the signing of the Treaty of Ankara, the Turkish nationalist movement had achieved victory in the Franco-Turkish War. The treaty legitimized Kemal's government, cleared the way for further allied concessions to the Turks on the Treaty of Sèvres, and allowed the Turkish army to concentrate against the Greek forces in central Anatolia. It also meant the virtual end of the centuries-old Armenian and Eastern Christian communities in Cilicia and southern Anatolia. French Colonel Édouard Brémond commented on the trauma that he witnessed. After all the atrocities that have occurred in this country, fear has become a mental illness that will take generations to heal. But the Treaty of Ankara did not end the Turkish War of Liberation, and on other fronts, there was much more fighting to come. For a conflict that affected the lives of hundreds of thousands of people, the Franco-Turkish War in Cilicia doesn't get much attention, and that's why we made today's episode. But frankly, if we only made our living with YouTube, we couldn't do it with topics like this one. History is, in the grand scheme of YouTube's gigantic reach, not sexy enough for advertisers or to go viral. That's why we use crowdfunding on Patreon for projects like our series on the Franco-Prussian War called Glory and Defeat. Without your support outside YouTube, we wouldn't exist. Another pillar of support for us is Nebula, a creator-driven streaming platform we built together with other educational YouTubers. On Nebula, you can watch all our content ad-free and support creators more directly than on YouTube. We'd like to thank Joey Vonken for his help with this episode. As usual, you can find all our sources for the episode in the video description. If you want to support our channel, you can support us on Patreon. The links are in the video description below as well. I'm Jesse Alexander, and this is The Great War 1921, a production of Real Time History and the only YouTube history channel that views the demonetization of history videos as an unfriendly act.